categories, like being US citizen, permanent or conditional resident, and also non-immigrant. And of these three subcategories, they also have their own unique definitions. So discussing about the undocumented status, it was recorded that in 2016, according to the US Department of Education, an undocumented immigrant population ranges around 11.3 million in 2016. As you can see in the blue area, the range is 71% originate from Mexico, Central America. As you can see in the purple, it's around 13.1% from Asia, and so on. So regarding the actual undocumented student population, it was recorded that 65,000 undocumented students actually graduate from high school each year, but only 5 to 10% of this quantity are actually enrolled in colleges. So now that I discussed a bit of the context, I should emphasize that for my methodology, because there's little research done on Chicanx students, I'm going to review the issues in the African-American population and compare it to the Chicanx experience. The two areas of research in the African-American population are going to mirror the same pathway for undocumented Chicanx students, that being implicit bias and criminalization. So in an educated population, we often assign labels and damaging stereotypes for students of color, which can actually diminish their status without us fully being conscious of it. So it actually introduces the question of whether we actually have implicit bias towards certain students of color. Is it possible that some teachers and faculty may expect and anticipate more troublemaking behavior, causing them to unfairly scrutinize them? I argue that it is. So a study conducted by Yale University's Child Study Center explored the biases in faculty that might have a troubling pattern in elementary and secondary schools. That issue being that African-American students are suspended or expelled at more than twice the rate of children compared to any other ethnicity. So basically, researchers examined 135 early career education professionals. They were formed by researchers to expect challenging behaviors while watching a couple videos of preschoolers. And the preschoolers themselves were just interacting in typical activities, whether it's just playing with each other or playing with a couple toys or art supplies. What the researchers did not tell the faculty is that there was actually no problematic behaviors at all. What the faculty were actually told to press a key every time on a computer, every time he or she expected some sort of potential challenge. So that challenge being either the expected a disruptive behavior, maybe a form of aggressiveness or disruptiveness. And then pretty much the computer reported which students the faculty observed the most. So the results were actually really interesting. What was concluded is that the preschool teachers show a tendency to more closely observe the black students, and especially the boys, when challenging behaviors were actually expected. So the studies concluded that teachers may have a higher standard of behavior for black children. They could be stereotyped and they're most likely to behave. This perhaps contributes to the racial disparity in discipline and high expulsion rate, where African-American students are actually exposed to the criminal justice system at a higher rate compared to any other ethnicity. So this is defined by researchers as called the school to prison pipeline, where it's defined as the process of students being pushed out of schools and into prisons. For example, according to the US Department of Education, it concludes that there were 49 million students enrolled in K-12 education in 2016. As you can see in the two categories focusing for white students and African-American students, you can see the white students contribute towards 51% of the population versus 60% of the population for African-American. However, regarding the quantity of multiple suspensions, white students only account for 31%, while black students account for 41%, which is a pretty huge difference. So the evidence shows that school-to-prison pipeline primarily captures and affects black students. In addition to that, black students are also responsible for 31% of school-related arrests, were suspended and expelled 3 times more than white students, and 3 times more likely to be in contact with the juvenile system that following year. So now that I explored the biases, which can contribute towards the criminalization for African-American populations, I'm not going to compare how that similar pathway can also affect the Chicanx experience regarding similarities. So could the same factor of bias also affect the Chicanx population in terms of academic performance? So just like the school to prison pipeline affects African-American students, the Chicano students are actually affected by a pipeline called the Chicano Educational Pipeline, which is defined as the pathways taken by students through the educational system. And that system itself has leaks, metaphorically, which refers to low-income students and or students of color that are pushed out of academics. So Chicano students have the lowest academic performances, so meaning they have the lowest graduation rates from high school, they obtain the least amount of college degrees, and often perform the largest in gap in the math and sciences. So in terms of being the lowest, being undocumented on top of that actually has a much more negative effect. So for example, a study comparing the academic pathways between being a U.S. citizen and not U.S. citizen. You can see how both groups began with 100 students each. You can see how the graduation rates decreased rapidly. So being a U.S. citizen goes to 56. Not a U.S. citizen goes down to 35. And we've seen the actual college degree, so you can see how being a U.S. citizen, you have a 15 out of 100 chance of attaining a college degree, versus not a U.S. citizen, you have an 8 out of 100 chance of attaining a college degree. So it's pretty much decreased by half not being a U.S. citizen. So as you can see, being a U.S. citizen pretty much has an advantage. So not just an advantage academically, but also the advantage of not having to worry about being deported. For example, in 2009-2013, Orange County detained approximately 43% of California's youth subject to ICE holds, and 82.5% of this quantity happened to be Mexican, but only 45.6% of this quantity had no documented criminal history other than trespassing in the country illegally. So in correlation with the given statistics, I wanted to note the experiences of my campus regarding Chicanx and Mexican students. So I conducted studies at my college, which is Mira Costa College. So I did a quality study about Tulsa, identified Chicano, Mexican, Mexican-American students, and investigated the themes of their experiences on campus based on their racial identity, investigated their interactions and experiences with faculty as well. And these were 8 to 17 minute interviews, and I asked them 10 questions, and their identities were kept anonymous. So in terms of identity, the racial identities, 5 identified to be Mexican, 3 identified to be Mexican-American, 3 Chicanx, and 1 Latino-Hispanic. In addition, I asked the participants if whether they see themselves as having less, more, or the same opportunity as other students because of racial identity. As you can see in the right chart, it shows that 1 student said they have more, 5 of them have the same, and 6 of them have the less. It's actually quite opposite of what I expected. I expected more students to say even less opportunity. In addition to that, so these are some of the statements regarding the actual interview statements that when I was interviewing these students. And then another additional question was, why do Hispanic and Latino students demonstrate the lowest educational attainment? So it's actually surprising. The results showed that 9 students claimed it was because of cultural influence, which I'll explain a little bit later. And 3 claim to be because of academic institutions. So for those who think, and for institutions, it said that the United States is aware of these problems of the lowest attainment rate, but they're not actually doing anything. And those who claim it was because of cultural influence, most said because it has to do with the family culture. So they described that the Mexican culture focuses more on work priority versus education priority, which was kind of unexpected for me. And then most of these participants do come from immigrant families, so they're always like discouraged to continue higher education because work and family is always number one. So in addition to that, the participants are not described to have any racial profiling experiences on campus, which is really good, and also described their experience with faculty to be pretty good as well. Now, while it's not present at Mira Costa College to an extent, that's good, but that doesn't mean that it's not present at other institutions. So, however, regarding undocumented Chicanx students, if the issue is not because of faculty bias, but perhaps it's actually because family are not fully aware or supportive of the academic opportunities your children have in the country. So this can be because most families come from an immigrant background and often have to work like long shift hours, like 8 to 12 hour shifts. You sometimes don't have the time, money to simply invest in your kids to be more involved in their academics. So that kind of impact from a young age can really hinder their motivation, which kind of contributes to why the students are correlating with the educational pipeline, why Chicano students are at the lowest attainment. So their own parents kind of present a barrier, which is kind of ironic, but as fellow students, professors, and mentors, we can provide these parents to participate in events like financial aid workshops, panel of alumni students, to see the wonderful opportunities of education and how this can actually help their children and their family versus not damaging them. So actually myself and all of you can provide a push so that these underrepresented students can become new scholars, leaders, and innovators of tomorrow by kind of promoting these events of financial aid workshops and encouraging these parents that education is something really valuable not everybody has. And encouraging these parents that these sort of sacrifices for an education is gonna help not just their parents, not just the kids, but the community as well. And I hope to see that one day the statistics can be reversed and Chicano students can be hopefully one of the highest academic performances. So yeah, that's pretty much my presentation.